when the bus stopped on a hill. Baby sister said it was in Florida, but I think it was in, where else did it was? Okay, we'll say Florida. Missouri, okay. And so the bus stopped on the hill, so the guy came up and said, and we gotta watch this boy. Who this bus belong to? We don't mind no niggas in this town after 6 o'clock. Daddy said, well, the bus is broke down and won't stop. He said, I don't care. I work with niggas, but we don't mind no niggas in this town after 6 o'clock. And I'm going back, and we'll come back. If y'all be here, it's gonna be. So he left, and a guy over there said, look here, if y'all can get that bus up past that telephone post up there, you'll be out of the city limits. So everybody had to get out of the bus. And they pushed the bus up the hill past that telephone post. And just as they were getting up there, here comes the guy with the pickup truck with guys and rifles and stuff, and you know, ready to match, ready to kill, you know. And they looked at this guy over there and said, you told them niggas where that telephone post was, didn't you? Now, but that ain't the only part. The part I want to play for you is another guy coming in the opposite direction. And I got a little stuff here for where Daddy said he saw a guy coming there with his son. And play that.
There's a white man, he had a truck, and the Lord haven't had a tow check in his name and everything, going a different direction, and I had a little boy in there with him, his son, found my lady. I think the boy about 6 years ago, not over 7, a small boy. I flagged him down, and I said, how far is the next town in this direction? He said, oh, I guess 8 to 10 miles. So I said, well, could I pay you to tow me up there? He said, no, I can put you up there, but you can't pay me.
He said, you cannot pay me. So he took him up there and brought him back. And so, once again, Daddy said, well, can I give you something? And the guy said, no. Daddy said, well, can I give your son something? The guy said, turned to his son and said, son, we are not charging these people. He is going to give you a little something. He said, but it's giving you a gift, but it's not for us helping these people and taking them up there. You're talking about a good white man who's teaching good shit to his son, too. Now, we're going to get down to Benny. We got a, speaking of white people, we tease each other, so don't get talk about that. This guitar player's name is, we call him Cooney Mooney. Ricky said, tell him his real name. His real name is Earl Cooney. I call him Cooney Mooney.
Thank you.
So, next, I'm here. So, right now, I'm going to ask who you want. George. Great that came through. singer who is living in Paris now. I think he's about 98 years old. But he's still talking, he's still cool man cool. He came to my birthday party. Now, let me get out of here. So this guy was my boss so many years. Fred was my boss. I traveled all over the globe with him. But I keep reminding him, I'm their boss tonight. We're going to have a little marriage now again as a country.
I'm so happy to be here. I'll tell you a little story. I was from Louisiana, and we moved out to LA, and I was just trying to figure out, you know, what I wanted to do with my life, and so I found music found me, and I was really happy. We got to have a great relationship, but I still didn't figure out how I could make money with that. I mean, playing is fun, but I need to figure out how to make money. And I was living in this little back house in Watts, and was practicing a lot and meeting a lot of musicians. And everyone knew that, you know, to get a work call from Ernie Fields Jr. meant that you might be going places. So I brought this little phone machine. I don't know if you guys remember the phone me, you know, because you couldn't, if you weren't at home, you didn't know who called. So I bought this little machine and I saved up this $120, which might have been $1 million to me at that time. But I saved up and I got the machine. And I was always afraid to leave the house because somebody might call. So I waited and just zero. No calls, no messages. So finally I went across the street to the neighborhood store where I had some credit and got me a, you know, sandwich and stuff. And I came back and the light was blinking. One call, missed. And I played it back. It's Ernie Fields Jr. Work call for Ricky Minor, Fender Bass, tomorrow, 3:00, call back. So, and you know, those days, they just go down the list. I mean, I don't even know how I got my name or number, but they just go down the list, and if you missed a call, you just missed it. And so I called back, I said, Mr. Fields? He said, yeah. I said, this is Ricky Minor, I'm gonna return the call. Is it too late? Did you call, did you go on and call somebody else? He says, no. He says, you got the call, and it's tomorrow at 3:30 at the Debbie Reynolds studio, and be there, and don't be late. And I said, okay, thank you, get the address. Oh, Mr. Fields, can you tell me who I'm playing with? You know, because I'm going to call my mom and say, I got a job. And so Ernie, in his beautiful way, said, don't worry about it, just don't be late. So that was my introduction to Ernie, and it's a lifelong friendship, and so I'm happy to be here to support anything that he does. So shortly after that, I moved on and got a job working with Gladys Knight and the Pips. I was about 19, and then I went on to do other jobs, and I got a call from a guy that I met, said, I got this girl that sings in my church, and she's trying to get a record deal, and she's gonna come to LA, and can you put a band together and see? And so that girl was 18, and now I'm 22 years old at the time, and you know, I worked with Gladys Knight, I've been around, I know things. And so I'm talking to this girl, and we did the showcase, and she didn't get a record deal at that time, and we were talking, and I was telling her, you know, the business is hard, and you just gotta stick with it. And anyway, that girl was Whitney Houston. A long friendship, a lifelong friendship, and we were together for 30 years making music. So this is a song that almost didn't get recorded. She was doing the movie, The Bodyguard, and they were trying to find a song for the end credit, the song that played at the very end, to show that these two people won't be together. And so they had a song, and they called me about it, and the song was, What Becomes of a Broken Hearted? And so we were set to record that song, and then a movie came out, Fried Green Tomatoes, and they used the song. So we had to find another song. So they went on searching for a song, and it turns out that when they found I Will Always Love You, the story that Dolly Parton says is that, you know, she had this song and Elvis wanted to record it. But they called and said, listen, the only way Elvis would record it is if he owns half of this song. And at the time, you know, Elvis was a big star, and Dolly just said, look, I write my songs and I keep my songs and I own my songs. So, you know, years later, she stuck our guns and 100% of that song is owned by Dolly Parton. So this is a little country and pop come together.
Thank you. Yeah, no, I
mention a very good guitar player who's from Old Muggy, Oklahoma. His name is Jimmy Nolan, and he was instrumental in a lot of bands around here. Jimmy Nolan, you know Jimmy Nolan? Yeah. He played on Pompano Team, No Mads, Big Payback, all of the big hits from Dan Brown, Jimmy Nolan played on. Jimmy Nolan, give Jimmy Nolan a big round of applause. And we like to get everybody involved, whether it be black, white, blue, or green, red, yellow, or in between. Everybody can bump together. We're going to do this tune. Let's see if you know it. They go like this.
Thank you.
telepads, the one of the funkiest telepads in the whole wide world. I'm talking about Ernie Fields Jr. Come on, Ernie, get back here. We want somebody else to play. We want Miguel Gummit to play. And I believe,
yeah, who me?
B.B.